Yeah, it's kind of like when Roger Moore and Jaws man up.
Yeah, each other. You feel that when he puts his hand on your face, it engulfs everything. That's the size we're talking about here. Well, hello everybody. Welcome to Pod Hard. This is Jonas Högberg.
And Anders Hultqvist.
Yes, we're two fine fellows from Sweden talking about action movies in a very chronological way. We're tracing the evolution of action movies and the language of action movies. And this time we've finally reached the year 1928.
Yeah, we have got one hell of an arrangement here. We're going to start out with Buster's last independent movie, or what to call it. It's hard to call this an independent movie. It's one of the biggest goddamn blockbusters of all time.
Yeah, you're talking about Steamboat Bill Jr.
Yeah, Buster really puts the Buster in blockbuster.
Yeah, definitely.
And then we're going to end on his first big company flick, MGM movie, The Cameraman. And we use this little movie that you found as an interlude, more or less. Mm.
Yeah, it's, what would you, I guess you would, in the Swedish, you would call this a pilsner film, I think. This is a very rambunctious comedy, which we'll be talking about, Feel My Pulse, with Bebe Daniels, one of the big stars of the 20s.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, how do you pronounce Bebe?
I think it's Bebe. Bebe Daniels. And our good pal Richard Arlen from Wings, who is so goddamn like Crispin Glover that we're constantly amazed. And also William Powell, who will be getting a lot of interesting roles in the 30s and 40s as a talking actor.
Yeah, but you're steaming ahead, Jonas.
Yeah, we're steaming ahead. We are concentrating this episode on Steamboat Bill Jr. And for once, we actually saw the movie together over Skype, which is a bit weird, but it almost felt like old times when we did our Swedish podcast and we sat in the same couch and watched the movies and then did the podcast after.
The memories.
So we're almost getting back to that magical feel, Anders. It feels great.
Oh, so this is the nostalgia episode.
Well, I have to say, we chose the perfect movie for getting back together again. The Steamboat Bill Jr. was amazing. I think this probably is my favorite Buster Keaton movie. I'm throwing it out there. This is my favorite Buster Keaton movie.
Yeah, that was my line.
Oh, damn.
I just love how he goes so all out, big, bold, set piece extravaganza in this one. He just pulls all stops when the storm hits the town.
I mean, it's like blockbuster of today. The special effects, of course, there's no computer effects here. Everything is done for real. And I mean, he's trashing a city. He's trashing an entire city in this movie.
Yeah. It's just one of those huge set pieces. I mean, yeah, it's destroying downtown Chicago like they do now every summer blockbuster or something. It's really cool.
Yeah, yeah. So, but let's not get ahead of ourselves. Let's start the movie off at the beginning. First, we get this Straub and Hulé pan.
Is that what it
is?
I
don't know what it is. It's what do you call it in English? A pan? A pan?
Yeah,
a pan. Yeah. So not a tilt, yeah. A pan.
And you said, oh, a strobilia.
Yeah, we went to film school together, and then we had a teacher who talked a lot about strobilia, who is like a very...
Isn't it Straub?
Straubhulia?
Yeah, Julia? I suppose, yeah.
Why are we talking about strobilia now? I don't...
I haven't seen much of their... repertoire.
Well, they're very arty and do very slow pans.
This pan isn't that slow, but it's pretty even.
Yeah, it's pretty even. That's why I immediately thought, oh, strobilhulia, okay.
I mean, you're not too far out there. I watched Pedro Costa's documentary on strobilhulia.
Yeah,
a couple of years back, and they talk a lot about Charlie Chaplin as an as an influence. No, not influence, but his importance to cinema.
Okay, but not Buster Keaton
in staging, and not that I remember. Okay. But Buster Keaton does have a mustache in this one.
Yeah. We'll get to that as well. But yeah, the pan was in the beginning. We thought, wow, what a pan! But then the pan stopped. And then it continued.
Yeah.
What was that?
Stop and continue is odd choice. I liked how quick it stopped because it was just dead. I mean, most pans slow down a bit before they stop. But this was just...
I love that we give so much space, room for the opening pan of the movie.
Yeah, I was going to say that you took it too far when you said that we used to pick movies apart down on very small, minuscule detail level, but here we are, I suppose.
Yeah, we did that, Anders. We did that. And we're doing that as well. But yeah, so anyway, Steamboat Bill Jr., as the movie alludes to, the movie's name alludes to, it's a movie about big steamboats down in Louisiana or that neighborhood, I would assume.
Yeah, there's a new there's a new steamboat in town. Or my trailer voice.
Oh, okay.
There's a new steamboat in town.
Yeah, it's a nice big new steamboat that is all shiny and bright. And the old steamboat, well, not that interesting anymore. And that old steamboat is being commanded by Steamboat Bill. And now Steamboat Bill gets a letter. Oh, my son is coming for the first time since I was... since he was a little baby. I haven't seen him since.
I thought you were going to say since I was a baby.
Yeah.
I haven't seen. But his boatsman also, he says, looks like you have to look for a new river.
When the big boat, big new boat comes.
Yeah. And Steamboat Bill, he's what a man. He's a big guy.
Yeah. We talked about that. Buster Keaton had a fondness for using big guys as his heavies, as the bad guys. Now, Steamboat Bill isn't a bad guy in this movie, but he is a bit of a foil in the later part of the movies when he's trying to stop Buster from seeing the other steamboat captain's daughter. So
you said his hands were like frying pans.
Yeah, frying pans or like what do you call dasslock in English?
Yeah, you said dasslock.
Dasslock, yeah. Outdoor lavatories had like this big lid. So yeah, it's an outdoor lavatory lid. That's how big his hands are.
Yeah, it's kind of like when Roger Moore and Jaws man up.
Yeah. You feel that when he puts his hand on your face, it engulfs everything. That's the size we're talking about here.
So where were we?
Yeah, well, Steamboat Bill Jr. comes to town. Well, he is actually called Willie in this movie. Which is not that good name for a Buster Keaton character in my mind.
I haven't seen my Willy.
Yeah, we were a bit confused in the beginning. Like, is he talking about his downstairs equipment or what is going on here? But
will we receive a rating now?
But no. No, he was actually talking about his son. And
to be recognizable, Buster Willy Keaton will wear a coronation flower.
Mm, yeah.
When he arrives at the train station. But everyone has one of these, more or less. So, yeah, Steamboat Bill goes around and checks out, tries to find a real solid log of a man.
Yeah, and he has a fantastic vest on that almost looks like it's
Buster.
Yeah, Buster Keaton has this nice vest, checkered. And it looks almost a bit like 8-bit gamey style. So I was almost thinking, you should have one of those vests. That looks great.
Yeah, but his style overall, I mean, he's some kind of proto-bohemian art type. Mm. He carries his little... what is this? It's not a guitar. It's
ukulele?
Ukulele. Is it called ukulele in English? Yeah, I suppose so.
I think so. I can do a fast check for you.
And he has a basker.
I think so, yeah.
No, is it called basker? I'm a
basque.
Isn't
it
man.
Just basque?
Basque.
Beret.
First I thought
beret.
You said...
It's a beret.
Beret. It's a beret. First I thought you said bass. He had a big fish on his head.
What? No, it's a bass. A bass. A beret. Well, this is going great. This is just going great. So anyway, he finally finds his dad after a whole set of misadventures. He's playing ukulele to a... Oh, yeah. He almost kills a baby by sitting on it. And a baby does a great stunt when falling over. Oh, I'm dead. Great. Love it.
It's a YouTube moment.
Yeah, definite YouTube moment.
And his dad is so ashamed when he figures out this is his son. This small, weird-looking fella.
Mm, yeah.
Nerdy. I guess. I mean, dad acts with his face, kind of like these bug-eyed Popeye characters that often show up in these movies. But this guy is so good at it.
Yeah.
I kind of let him slide. I think he's acts
like,
with his whole face.
He's like the ultimate version of the Popeye character going.
Yeah, I wouldn't call him toned down, but in it because it's all over the place. But there's some, it's a purity, I suppose. Elevated Popeye.
Elevated Popeye. So the elevated Popeye guy, he tries to kit Buster with some... better garment. First of all, he tries to give him a better hat since the beret just isn't cutting it for him. So he takes Buster to a hat shop. Buster tries on like 200 different hats, and he has his porcupine hat just for a second. He's very conscious about it. When the porcupine hat comes and he puts it on, he puts it down immediately, as if it's almost like an inside gag. Like only the real Buster Keaton fans know that this is a gag. This is a joke. That he, if you missed that, well, that's on you. You should be paying more attention.
Yeah, it's fun because it goes on forever. This hat scene,
yeah.
But I identify very much with Buster Keaton here because every hat sits on top of his head and doesn't fit very well. So I said he doesn't have a hat head. Mm. I mean, he doesn't fit in hats, and I don't either. But anyway, directly when he goes out, it blows away. So the whole scene is for nothing, more or less. It's very fun.
And he also gets rid of the mustache here. Because that's just an abomination to the dad, that kind of mustache. And it's not full Charlie Chaplin mustache. It's a bit more elongated over the brow of the mouth. But I did think it was a minor diss at Charlie. Maybe. Maybe I'm just hoping for rivalry and some brouhaha between the greats, but...
You leave it open that you read too much into facial hair.
I always do. I always do. Maybe it's a diss at Douglas Fairbanks.
Yeah, that now you're onto something.
Yeah, because that it's more of a Douglas Fairbanks mustache, really. So anyway, he gets a pretty nice costume, actually. Looks like he's a dapper captain on a quite high upstandard boat, really. He isn't really par with the boat itself, because everybody's burly, manlish, goes around pushing people around like that. And so the Steamboat Bill, the Popeye, the elevated Popeye character, his best mate on the boat, tells him he almost hands him a gun and means that he should shoot his son. No jury would convict you, as the intertitle reads, which was a bit weird. And this is a boat that is. Well, it has seen better days. Buster accidentally knocks a lifeguard out of the boat and into the water, and the lifeguard sinks immediately to the bottom. And that's just how crummy this boat is.
Yes, and then he walks around a bit on the boat, and someone pulls the rope on him. And into one of these wonderful pratfalls. And we will see a lot of them in this one.
Yeah.
Where he twirls in the air and almost always lands on his head, more or less?
Great.
I love those. There is no equal.
No, nobody can do those as Buster Keaton can. I mean, he was an expert at falling. He had this body control that no other person had. Which I guess stemmed from that he was being thrown around at like 3 years of age or something. So he had lots and lots of practice on this. And I mean, we see some other pratfalls from other people that are pretty good. But I mean, this amazing thing when he almost does... So when he does these somersaults and like throws himself up in the air and around like 360 degrees... and falls on his neck. I mean, they look so... I mean, his limbs are everywhere in the air. He's not just doing a standstill somersault backwards. He's twirling his body like he... I don't know, like he's being thrown out of bed or something. It's
yeah, shot out of a cannon.
It's crazy. And he does so this movie.
You know what we're going to have to call? It's elevated pratfalls. You know it.
Okay, so elevated Popeye, elevated pratfall. Great stuff already from this podcast. I'm going to talk like Popeye now for the rest of the podcast. Mm.
Calling things what they are. There's a long scene where there's this back and forth between the boats. You know, they push him, push him over to this other guy, King is his name, the guy who has the new, who owns the whole town, more or less. Buster has an interest in his daughter, played by Marion Byron. So they push him back and forth between the boats. This is a scene that drags. They always have these gags that don't really go anywhere and get plenty of time to develop. Mm. So I guess they just try out some stuff and see which works better at times. Mm. But it has a nice ending where there's a guy pushing him and they both fall over and they are like entangled. Mm. Tangled up.
Yeah.
And fall back. It looks cool.
Yeah, definitely. So a lot of people go into the water here.
So dad asks him to hit him, use your hands what they are made for. And when he hits him, he gets a sore hand. It really hurts. I was thinking about Jackie Chan often has those moments where he hurts himself and play it up.
So he got that as well from Buster Keaton. He's shown around the boat. He has some more silly stuff when trying out the commands for the boat, and they're bumping into this new boat. And then it's nighttime. Buster lies in his bed, and at his foot side, there's this is by far the weirdest thing of this entire movie. So there's like bits and pieces of a coconut lying at the foot end of the bed.
Wasn't it cocoa nut? Could it be cocoa beans or something? Are they in shell? We thought it was peanuts.
Yeah, it looked more like peanuts, but the intertitle says it's like coconut bits, which is very weird.
So it's full of it on the floor.
Yeah.
And they keep stepping in it and hurt their feet.
Yeah.
It's really odd.
So it feels like there's a scene missing here where he's consuming a coconut.
I mean, maybe it was because the prior scene he swallowed some chewing tobacco and is out cold.
Mm.
So maybe it was for his stomach
to eat a coconut.
To eat something, I mean.
Yeah, but why a coconut?
Anyway, it's the word of the... Maybe at the end we should edit together all the anyways.
Anyway, so like anyway.
So anyway.
Yeah, anyway.
Yeah, anyway, he's gonna sneak out and meet up with... is she called Kitty?
Kitty, yeah, Kitty.
Kitty, Marion's character. So... there's a back and forth with dad who won't let him. But when he finally sneaks out, he has one amazing three-level pratfall climbing out, falling several levels, one at a time. But yeah, it's great.
Mm. Yeah, and we need to take notice of the fact that when he climbs out, Buster is dressed in a jacket that is like five sizes too big for him, and we of course immediately thought of Gary Daniels.
I mean, you immediately thought of Gary Daniels. I think he haunts you since I've pushed you to watch Recoil.
Yeah. Gary Daniels, of course, a crappy action star of the 90s.
I mean, come on, man.
But the thing that...
Why you gotta go there?
I think the greatest thing with Gary Daniels was the size of his t-shirts. They were like five sizes too big for him. And here we see Buster Keaton showing us how it's done.
It's pretty awesome when he gets out of those t-shirts as well.
Yeah, well, it's pretty okay.
Yeah, let's leave Gary Daniels for the moment, but I will
for
remember
the moment,
this.
For the moment, yeah.
We will get to him in the 1980s, 1990s.
Yeah, so anyway... yeah, Buster has this great triple somersaults here when trying to get over to the other boat.
And when balancing on a plank between the boats, there's this dude coming, throwing a cat and...
a boot.
Losing his boot in the process.
Yeah, and the boot becomes like the balancing thing on the plank so that Buster can stand outside, onto the side of the plank that is over the water. But how he's being lifted up by a boot on the other side, I fail to notice. It has to be like this sea jargon, like your boots are like so extremely messy, naughty, filthy, that they're like filled with filth, and maybe that equals like another person.
Oh, okay. You thought like I was thinking that he still is supposed to be a bit portrayed like a weak person,
a lightweight character.
a lightweight character, exactly. But but I guess the boot has to be weigh something.
Could be a bit of both, I guess. Yeah. So anyway, anyway, he gets on board the other boat, and there's a bit of a brouhaha where the captain is like jettisoned out into the water, and another boatsman into the water, and then when another comes and finds Buster, Buster just fuck it, I'll jump into the water myself. So yeah. And his father, the elevated Popeye character, is very disappointed with him because, well, he's obviously trying to meet up with the girl, which is his rival's daughter. And, well, such a marriage is not possible, of course. So the father just sends Buster packing at the dawn of light. He gives him a train ticket and some money. Just get the hell out of my sight, you wretched man. I want nothing to do with you. How can you do this to me? But then the elevated Popeye character gets into trouble, Anders.
Steamboat Bill, yeah. His this other character, King, who more or less owned the whole town, gets... Buster's dad's riverboat out of commission. It's gonna be... Yeah, it's too crappy. So there's a scuffle, and dad is arrested.
Mm. Oh, no.
And about now it starts to rain. There's heavy rain and strong winds. Mm. Buster is on his way to his dad with the biggest loaf of bread ever. In the history of mankind.
Yeah, and he's filled this loaf of bread, of course, with like saws and files and tools, essentially, for his dad to break out of jail. And there's a quite funny bit with the sheriff when he's going back and forth and they're trying to get the loaf to the dad, and the dad doesn't want anything to do with Buster. But when Buster cracks the top of the bread open and shows the dad, hey, there's a lot of tools in here, then it becomes, oh, yeah, get it over to me. But then the sheriff is like, oh, no, this sounds suspicious. Why the sudden turn? And so they're playing around with this. Quite amusing.
I love the detail when Buster finds a loose string on the sheriff and pulls it. Yeah. And it's a very long string he pulls out of his clothes. And back and forth. And in the end, the sheriff more or less begs Buster to knock him on the jaw because the dad has called that Buster shouldn't let anyone treat him like that.
But that's after Buster has been exposed. The bottom has gone out of the bread, and all the tools have gone down on the floor. And Buster does this genius little thing where he like quickly opens the lid just to take a peek. Did that happen? What I just thought happened? Oh, the tools aren't there anymore, and he pops it back, and it goes so quickly. It's so nicely done. Great little detail there.
Yeah, he's good at those.
Yeah, and then he tries to knock the sheriff down, and he succeeds because he doesn't hit the sheriff in the jaw. He hits him in the stomach, his big, flappy stomach that doesn't have any protection at all. So
right in the gut.
The sheriff goes down.
And and then he gets that out, and they're gonna escape, but the rest of the police force arrives at the spot. So it ends with the sheriff knocking out Buster with a gun and tell one of his guys to drive him to the hospital. And now the rain has really intensified.
And another great detail when Buster, they flip Buster into the back seat of the car. It's an open car, of course. It's 20s. And we only see Buster's legs sticking out on top of the back seat of the car. And just as the car goes away, he crosses his legs in a very, 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 very nice manner.
And then he wakes up and just gets off in full speed.
Oh yeah, that's a great pratfall. I mean, this movie has some of the greatest pratfalls I've seen in my life.
Yeah, and many of them.
I mean, Buster, of course, named this as one of his most challenging shoots. He said he was battered at the end of it. Which is understandable, because he is really giving it to himself here.
Yeah, and right about now we arrive at the big set piece.
Yeah, there's like a tornado, man.
Yeah, there's a tornado hitting the town, and I mean, the whole town is destroyed in this storm.
Yeah.
And there are so many gags here.
Houses flying away,
riding on the bed, and a magic show, and yeah.
Everything. It's a gags bonanza. And it feels like, I mean, all of the gags are great. All of the gags
are
great.
Yeah, and they lead to each other. Yeah, and they lead to the next in great ways as well. And there's whole houses flying away, and then a house lands on top of him, and they crumble and fall apart. Walls fall down on him, and then he fly away on a tree.
Yeah, that was great too. But you know, the wall stunt is of course Buster Keaton's perhaps most famous stunt, where he's standing a bit knackered. And this entire wall of a house collapses down onto him, and he stands exactly at that spot where the window of the house is, so he doesn't get harmed at all. But of course, this was extremely dangerous because, I mean, it's not like a thin paper mache cutout of a wall. It's a real, it at least looks like a real wall. And when it falls down, it looks like a one hell of a impact on the ground.
Yeah, it looks like a solid wall.
From what I've read, actually the day he shot this, he was told that I don't think he owned the studio, but it was his studio, that he could do anything at all that he wanted to. And he sort of had almost this complete control over his movies. All that was taken away when the owner sold everything. And Buster was forced to take this deal with MGM. And he got this news at the day when he shot this wall stunt. So he apparently didn't even care if the wall killed him here. He was so depressed. And all of the crew members, they didn't want to watch this when this stunt went down. So everybody turned their backs on Buster when the wall fell, because everybody thought, man, he's going to get killed now.
He's going to get flat.
This is it, man.
But I mean, that's even worse when they when they turn around again and there's no one there. Would be,
oh, he's squashed. Okay.
Okay.
Well,
that's
now
a wrap.
That's a wrap.
So and he mirrors the scene beautifully in another scene, but in a smaller way, when he is going to exit a door and the wall collapses.
Yeah.
When he exits the door.
Oh man, such a great shot as well. Fantastic.
Yeah, beautiful.
And the door is up in the air when the wall is down. And it's so ergonomically beautiful in a sense. you get these lines and shapes, and I mean, this must be like a mathematician's dream or something, with all these straight lines and shapes, and it almost feels like an algebra lesson or something, I don't know. that is like being taken part in the forcing houses and buildings and walls and doors, and there's so many shapes and positions and so much awesomeness going on here that I just can't fathom it all, man. And yeah, as you said, there's a magic show as well with a lot of crazy things happening. He does a magic trick unknowingly, where a shower curtain is being rolled down on him. And when it goes up, he's disappeared into a box down there. He gets up and is a bit peeved. What happened? And he's being thrown around in this house, and there's a ventriloquist dummy that is being used in some funny ways as well. And when the winds hit him out in the street, I mean, man, these wind cannons, where did they come from, and where did they go? Why hasn't Hollywood used these kinds of effects anymore? I haven't seen it. I mean, he
can more or less stand.
He stands at 45 degree angle. He can walk towards the wind. He tries to jump towards the wind, but that doesn't work at all.
There's a beautiful shot when he comes in frame, gliding on his ear, upside down, more or less, in the mud.
Yeah,
it's
that's
amazing.
Great. And there's a lot of boxes hitting him in the wind as well.
And we talked about that in the general, that he always glides into frame and ends up exactly where he wants.
Yeah.
And he even do this coming in on his face. I mean,
yeah,
this guy is a magician.
There's such precisement in everything. That's why I think it's a mathematician's dream, this movie.
And a magician's dream.
Yeah, definitely.
And in everything, just when he walks around, it's this total control of the body. You can feel when Buster is anxious or whatever it is.
He's trying to portray, the emotions and everything, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, man. So, and we even get a cartoon element in all this. He gets a jolt of lightning from an...
Electric wiring has fallen down.
And there's like a cartoon jolt being presented. That's something you don't see too much in these movies.
Might be the only element that has aged somewhat.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, and then he goes on this crazy line cart thing with a tree. That was also completely bonkers. I mean...
Yeah, he holds on to a tree that is ripped up and blows away. And it must be on a wire or...
A crane or something. It looks great.
I mean, he flies out and lands in the river.
Yeah.
It's really spectacular stuff. And now there are people on houses floating around on the river. Kitty is on one, so he's gotta save her first. Anyway, the whole prison goes down in the river with Dad in, and it's starting to sink. So now he is he ties up a bunch of ropes on the boat and just rams it right into the prison.
Yeah,
I thought it was gonna kill his dad, but I like that it makes it a save the dad variation instead of a save the girl, because that one is done very quickly and out of the way, and then there is more a more elaborate save the dad plot.
Yeah, it does some nice parkour jumping to get down to the dad from the top of the boat. And then he goes all the way back up again. He climbs very fast up the boat. So,
it's a really good parkour scene.
He sure has his athleticism. He can challenge Douglas Fairbanks every day of the week. And he does a nice swan dive as well. To save the rivaling captain, this king character that is Kitty's dad. He's being saved and everybody's happy. And Kitty feels like, it's you and me now. Then Buster gets this wild look in his face. And he just jumps off the boat. And everybody's like, Buster, where are you going? What is happening? And he's swimming away, and then he comes back. Oh, he's saved a priest. They're gonna get married on the boat. It's a great ending.
It's probably the best ending on a Buster Keaton movie I've seen. Now, maybe I have already forgotten some of them, but this is really funny.
Yeah. Yeah, we both of us were like, what's he doing? Why is he leaving everybody?
But yeah, he's getting the hell out of here.
Yeah, like we thought genuinely, what? He doesn't want anything to do with them? He's like getting the hell out of there? And then, oh, he's coming back with a priest. Okay.
The end.
The end. Great, great stuff.
I love that it just ends directly. Mm. On.
So this is how you make a movie, everybody. Do Steamboat Bill Jr. and you've made a movie. This is a
build
movie.
Build a town. Build a town and destroy it.
Destroy it completely.
And you will have a Podhard approved
masterpiece. Oh, yeah, definitely. This is... This is groovy.
So get out of there. With your film it with your iPhones. Just build up a town.
I mean, this movie is, of course, on YouTube, as many of the movies that we've seen during this roaring 20s
thingamajig
we've done here. So after you listen to this, you better get on YouTube and watch Steamboat Bill Jr. Yeah, great movie. Fantastic movie.
Yeah. So later we're going to get to his MGM debut, The Cameraman. Yeah. But before that, we take a slight intermission with Feel My Pulse.
Yeah, okay. Give me your hand then.
I got to say, I really enjoyed this one. I think it moves at a pretty good pace overall.
Yeah, it's only an hour long, so that's a great length as well.
Yeah, so Bebe Daniels plays this rich girl supposed to... She's been told all her life that she has a weak heart and I guess a bunch of other symptoms. So for 21 years, she has lived totally secured, I suppose.
Yeah, she has like an entire team of doctors around her all the time. That is like, as soon as she gets her pulse up a bit, they freak out. And they try to calm her down with medicine. And so they try to keep her stationary at all costs. It feels like she hasn't done anything in her entire life.
It's really odd. So this doctor, what's his face, has taken care of her for these 21 years. But now this utter madman, Uncle Wilberforce, comes on over and is going to take over the caretaking. Or
yeah,
something.
Very weird.
It's a really weird setup.
Yeah.
So he shows up screaming and shooting off his gun in the roof to prove that she does not have a weak heart, because then she should die from fear. So everyone is hiding and... I mean, this Wilberforce...
I mean, why wasn't he more in the movie? He would have made a great, chaotic force to the movie.
Why hasn't he interfered earlier as well?
Yeah.
He's waiting for 21st birthday. He shows up.
He appears not to know anything about her weak heart. He's like totally surprised.
So he screams, "You're going to the ranch. You need excitement, adventure, romance." And the doctor says, "He'll ruin 21 years of antiseptic supervision."
I mean, I love these intertitles in the silent movies.
There's a lot of intertitles in this one. It feels very, very dialogue-driven, back and forth.
It's too many intertitles, of course. I love it when they try to cut back on the intertitles, but when they do show up, they're very cleverly written.
I mean, this is, I guess this is a sense of this being on the cusp of sound cinema.
Yeah.
Because it feels more dialogue driven.
Yeah.
But there's some really nice puns and a lot of dad jokes.
Oh, that gets you going, isn't it?
Yeah, some of them were pretty funny. I actually laughed at some of the text. So she has forgot that she inherited a sanitarium where she can hide from this uncle and relax.
Yeah, so she
it's a brilliant setup.
She sets off for this sanitarium, without any of her doctors, which I thought was a bit weird, since she has been so diapered. Is that the word?
pampered.
She's been so pampered by her doctors for 21 years, but now all of a sudden she like takes off on her own to the sanitarium.
Yeah, but slowly throughout the movie, it peels back and show that she is awesome.
Yeah.
So I guess it starts here that she can leave this place. I guess
a small bit of rebellion.
Maybe she thinks there are doctors there, but the note she has where they send her news from the sanitarium, it says it's really dead here. Or something.
Yeah, and the sanatorium has been... it's not a sanatorium anymore. We, the audience, get in on the secret. It's actually been turned into a rum smuggling den.
Yeah, so it's a bandit's nest she will arrive
to. Yeah, the sanatorium is in an island in the middle of a lake somewhere. and it's like, there's bootleggers smuggling rum there. This is the 20s, and they didn't have access to alcohol in the USA.
We get a brief shootout.
That opens our time with the sanatorium.
Yeah, when the hijackers attack.
Yeah, the hijackers. So, very nice name for them. They just shout to each other, "The hijackers are here!" And then they run into the boss's office like, "The hijackers are here!"
So there's a brief shootout, and they chase away the hijackers, and then the movie goes back to being some kind of slight comedy. I mean, most movies, about 20 minutes in, I have almost started to wonder at every movie, why is Pod Hard watching this again?
Yeah, and you thought as much here as well?
Yeah. But but they get some really funny stuff out of that she believes that she's ill as well. I think Bebe Daniels is pretty funny.
She's gifted.
So
a gifted comedian.
I haven't seen anything with her before, but I recognize the name.
But she is being William Powell is the boss of this rum smuggling nest, and he tells Richard Arlen, the Crispin Glover lookalike.
Richard Arlen from Wings. Yeah. We just saw this guy.
He's back in business.
He's credited as her problem.
Yeah, I like that. And William Powell is credited as her nemesis. So everybody has her in front of their character's name or the person that they're playing here.
So definitely her movie.
Yeah, definitely.
So it's a nice throwback to the more female-driven movies of the tens, I suppose.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, in a sense, this did felt a lot like those serial movies. I mean, the plot is pretty haphazard at best, but they do tend to get some funny things out of it. I mean, Richard Arlen picks up Bebe Daniels at the train station almost by mistake because he doesn't really know who she is and that.
She thinks he's a taxi driver,
and he's so amused by her that he essentially gives up and okay, I'll give you a ride. As he does this, he is a terrible driver, or he drives very fast, and so she gets agitated, and so she tells him, "I have a heart problem. You need to chill down." Okay, I'll take it slow, but then her box, her suitcase filled with medicine. Goes it gets toppled over and it's left behind, and when she sees that, she jumps out of the car when it's going
at full speed. Not full
that's a nice stunt. She does that pretty good.
Yeah, and she runs like a mad woman.
Yeah, almost
after
like
her medicine.
Yeah, it almost like in in Kung Fu Hustle, that the Roadrunner-esque run.
You're right.
It's like super speed, supersonic speed. She runs back to get her medicine. And yeah. Richard Arlen's like, you have a heart problem? Did you just run like crazy now or something? So yeah, he takes her back to this sanatorium where everybody pretends to be a patient at the sanatorium, whereas they are really bad guys, criminals smuggling rum. Not sure why they pretend. they seem to be amused by her as much as Richard Arden is. William Powell gets wise that she's worth like $30 million or something, and he thinks like, oh, maybe I can get some ransom here. But not clear as to why they all fake the sanatorium bit, why they just don't kidnap her from the get-go. But yeah, so we get
before she arrives, there's a great scene with William Powell, the nemesis, when one of the guys, he asks one of the guys, what's she doing here? And he answers, she uses two big words for me. Mm. She talks like she was Jean Tunney's librarian. And
who's Jean Tunney?
I don't know. So I added, and Powell's reaction to this, he immediately picks up his gun and opens it and checks if it's loaded. So when upon hearing this, that she's like Jean Tunney's librarian, he is gonna shoot her up. Powell makes a great bad guy, I think.
Yeah, he's great. Jean Tunney, I just looked it up. He was a boxer.
Okay.
So, what?
Okay, so something to be very upset about.
Yeah, so he was a heavyweight boxer. Okay, weird. She punches him in the brain as if she were a Jean Tunney's librarian, I guess. Okay. So yeah, and we get a great scene of her getting plastered with a guy when he's getting loaded on her medicine and she gets loaded on rum. And they
switch medicine.
Yeah, and they sing a tune, merry tune together, and yeah, it's pretty good.
Yeah, and she is out surfing on a plank on the river, lots of odd stuff. I mean, she gets to be drunk, and she's doing lots of funny stuff.
Yeah, and then.
And Powell, the nemesis, he has an amazing scene when he enters a room knife first.
Oh yeah, that's at the beginning when she arrives. Sanatorium. Yeah,
exactly. A knife comes in a door, slowly entering a doorway, and then the arm comes in, and then Powell enters with a gun hanging sloppily in his pocket and chewing a mouth full of apple. I mean, this is an entree. This is an entrance.
In Pod Hard, we often talk about the bad guys needing to make an impression on the audience to sell their bad guy qualities. And this is certainly a way of doing that.
It's quality. And then when he goes around talking to his gang, he taps people with the knife when he's talking.
Yeah, that's great as well.
So it's very intimidating in a manner.
He's poking them in the tummy with the knife, like playingly. What?
And. And I love the gun hanging half out of his pocket in his suit.
Yeah, he has a very nice his clothes. I mean, he has like doctor's clothes on him, but very casual doctor's clothes. It's hard to describe, but he looks fantastic.
Yeah, she thinks he's the doctor anyway. And there's a long scene when he introduces her to the different patients when everybody is acting. There's some fun bits, but this is one of those scenes that is allowed to drag a bit, I think. But there's some great introductions. This is Wilfred. He sprained his head on a conference.
Yeah, that's pretty good. That's pretty good.
And there's another one. He's a very promising lawyer, but he tried to carry six suitcases on his own.
Oh man.
So anyway.
Yeah, anyway. So finally
Mr. Her problem, he has as Powell puts it, dollied up. He has never dollied up like this before there was a woman on the island, and lo and behold, he has transformed into Crispin Glover.
He goes full Crispin Glover.
Because at first part of the movie, I didn't really recognize him as the Crispin Glover dude from Wings. But here he is.
Yeah.
Back slick. Suit.
Dapper suit. He looks smashing as again.
I mean, is Crispin Glover actually a vampire?
Yeah.
So, the hijackers are back.
Yes, they are.
They shout and
yes,
and this is why Pod Hard is watching this movie.
Full brouhaha and Seuss.
There's an extended siege, mass shootout, brawl all over the hospital or the sanitarium.
Yeah, and there's like an army vehicle or something like an
army boat. I think they shoot with a cannon from a boat.
Yeah, they shoot a cannon from a boat and totally demolishes the room where Bebe Daniels is staying at. Crazy,
insane
crazy
stuff. And people throw people around and they shoot guns and there's smoke all over the place and they destroy it and yeah.
Yeah, great stuff.
Pod Hard is there.
Bebe Daniels is being, what do you call it, elevated down. She's being roped down from like the third floor by Richard Arlund. At the same time, he's trying to fight off an attacker. And she goes up and down in the rope in front of the house. Yeah, pretty good as well. And then,
and when she gets down, there's a beautiful shot where she's in the background trying to catch her breath from this JoJo thingamajig. And a gun appears up front, close.
In front
close
of the camera.
Up. Yeah, in front of the camera and shoots. And she jumps in the background. Mm. That shot is nice. But we get this. I want to comment on that. There's a long take. That is, there's a beautiful longer shot here where the camera follows them when they maneuver through this battlefield, which it has become, and they hide behind trees on the way while the camera moves along, and they can sneak in the smoke from the guns. There's smoke everywhere, so they hide behind trees and sneak in the smoke. I love this shot.
So anyway,
Powell appears out of the smoke.
Yeah, so William Powell he jumps out from a tree in a very cartoon manner. Points a gun at them and they take Richard Arlen, they knock him down and they take him into a room.
Yeah, and she goes crazy.
And yeah, Bebe Daniels goes bonkers because Richard Arlen has professed his love for her and all of a sudden she is like in love with him as well. And she says, nothing will stop me from
seeing
him.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with my heart. And I will follow my heart.
And she does some parkouring here. She jumps onto the stair from the side. And she runs up the stair. And then she finds a lot of rum kegs. And she throws them down like she's Donkey Kong
down
the stairs.
Yeah, she becomes a Donkey Kong.
And people are being bamboozled and thrown around.
And she starts throwing bottles. And she goes totally bonkers.
Yeah, and finally she finds a big bottle of chloroform
that will do it.
That she throws down the stairs, and when it hits and it's being shattered, and the liquid goes into the air, I mean everything goes into slow motion, and we get this beautiful scene where all the bad guys, there are perhaps like 10-15 of them. Down the stairs, they like swim around in this slow motion, and they're jumping from the staircases. And one dude does this salto mortal. What was that?
Somersault.
Now again?
No.
one guy does this somersault backwards in this slow motion take. I mean, crazy stuff is happening. And William Powell does this great thing where he like throws away his gun and throws himself into the wall and falls over. Fantastic. And so
and then
Bebe goes the Shining.
Exactly. She
crazy.
Goes.
She finds the axe and tries to break into Richard Arlen.
And then the cops arrive and arrest everyone. And when they are going to go up the stairs, Bebe starts to throw bottles and barrels at them as well. And some guys appear in the corridor and she starts to fight everyone. She gets to throw some punches in there and then she saves the guy.
Yeah,
she
refreshing.
Shinings him out of there, and we forgot to say that he is not a criminal. He is an undercover journalist. So he's a good guy as well.
So he's a good guy, and they can get married, of course. So yeah, that's the end of that movie, and well. It's a minor comedy, of course, but I did feel it was pretty snappy and thankfully quite short.
Yeah, it's nothing earth-shaking, but it is very enjoyable.
I mean, it's the middle of the movie. It drags a bit. I have to say, but many quite.
And
nice
I really like
here.
Her character. It's so corny and oddball.
Yeah, very refreshing when you've seen a lot of depressing roles for females.
I mean, Buster sometimes just put them in a sack. He doesn't know what to do with them. So this was very nice. It came at a good moment, I think. So maybe hyping it up a bit, but it was refreshing.
So 1928 is really pumping it up here. We've just finished watching Speedy, Harold Lloyd's contribution for 1928.
I had some hopes for this one, but it ain't Speedy. This one.
Yeah, so this is actually the first Harold Lloyd movie I've watched. Which I really thought was lackluster and not really giving us anything at all.
I mean, here he doesn't even play a character, more or less. He has always played these interesting characters, I think. Because I have talked a lot about how I can't really reconcile if he's an asshole, if he's cute. And it has always led to some... thinking or feeling, but I mean, here there is nothing that registers. But you know, back in the two-reeler stuff, I had some trouble with Lloyd as well. He was sometimes hitting it, sometimes losing it, and then I was very pleasantly surprised by Safety Last. I thought it was a big step forward in constructing a more long-form narrative structure, as well as Girl Shy, which is a masterpiece.
Yeah.
And he felt like he was leagues ahead of constructing these streamlined, tight narrative movies.
Yeah, where actually the narrative was moving things forward. Unlike many other silent movies where the narrative was like it was not even a narrative sometimes. I mean the Harold Lloyd movies, Girl Shy and Safety Last, they really remind us of movies of today with the plotting and the construction and everything. But
Waterboy as well, really
Waterboy.
Fresh. No, what was
the freshman?
The freshman
from 1925
was really fresh. He was a water boy.
Yeah, I mean the plot was pretty good in that one, and we did like For Heaven's Sake as well. But the kid brother was the beginning of the downfall, and we have maybe Maybe we have found the root of the problem. His directors, Fred C. Neumeier and Sam Taylor, they were the directors of his earlier movies, his great movies. But from the Kid Brother and forward, this guy Ted Wilde took over the directing duties. And yeah, I think it's noticeable that the narrative really has taken a pummeling in these later movies.
This is basically a two-reeler stretched out to feature length. This is something we have accused Buster of doing, but Buster has left Harold in the dust.
I mean, Buster always comes up with these great set pieces and gags that you can, oh, well, that's really funny, that's really incredible, that's really ingenuitive. So Buster always has something going for him, but it's very pedestrian made set pieces in Speedy. Essentially, the movie is about a guy. Yeah, it's about a guy. What's his game? He has like a girlfriend, and the girlfriend has like an old geezer dad who drives a horse-driven tram in New York
City. Wasn't it her granddad?
Yeah, her granddad. Yeah, and he drives a horse-driven tram, which apparently was a thing in the 20s in New York City. So Speedy is like a guy who can't hold down a job. He's like totally useless. So
he goes to Coney Island on a date maybe 13 minutes or something.
There's no plot like for the first hour or so in this movie. What is happening? It's just Harold Lloyd mucking about. This essentially was like Harold Lloyd doing a journal movie of Coney Island, because it's really nothing happening here plot-wise. He and his girlfriend is simply going around to different attractions, and
it's a montage. It's transitioning different scenes where they try out stuff.
Yeah, but it's a montage that is like 10-15 minutes long.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But 1 hour in or something, he overhears a phone call that they are gonna send some
brutes. You're like jumping over a whole lot of the movie.
Yeah, but we said the movie should have started here, where he overhears this, and it would have been like an Hitchcock thriller, a suspense movie. He overhears something.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, the movie should have started like at the 55-minute stretch. He has given Babe Ruth, like the America's most famous person, a ride in his taxi cab before this. And we thought we were going to get like, he needs to get Babe Ruth to the Yankee Arena in time. Babe Ruth, of course, was a big baseball player in the 20s. And he is in the movie playing himself. But the chase, it's not even a chase, and it's essentially just nothing, and they just sped him up driving a cab. They cranked
I think the joke is that he says drive faster, and the movie moves faster.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really nothing to talk about for Podhard, I would say.
Yeah, I'm so disappointed, because I was looking forward to two set pieces that I had read about. One big brouhaha brawl between some thugs and like the entire population of senior citizens in New York. It's like 200-300 old geezers running around pummeling bad guys. But
the idea is very fun.
The idea is great, but
having elderly people, but they can't throw punches, of course. Yeah. So it delves into nothing. But there are very many people on in this brawl. It's funny, but they don't do much. It was quite fun that it almost felt like a precursor to Warriors. There are two gangs of oldies coming out, with the one with the kitchen appliances, and one that has almost suited up in some kind of armor or something.
Yeah,
I don't know. But early Warriors, old geezer version. So the other big set
piece is supposed to be a chase at the end of the movie. And here we were both like clobbered that the back projection was awful. I mean, in an earlier episode, we talked about how the back projection is always good in silent movies.
We have seen a couple of... lesser
good back projections. Of course we've seen that. But... in this movie, it was so patently awful, the back projection in the chases, that we were both like, what? Are we watching a James Bond movie from the 60s again? What is happening?
Something to look forward to.
Yeah.
I mean, especially a letdown because of the masterpiece that is Girl Shy, because that end chase set piece holds up to anything.
Absolutely.
Today.
I mean, the...
And this does
the
not.
The chase scene in Girl Shy is probably top three chase scenes of all time. And this...
You know where you heard it
first.
Yeah,
definitely. And this, cast an awful shadow on that. That the same guy who did that does this. It's so disappointing.
I mean, and it's also that it's just... it just starts and then it cuts away to an old geezer and or he gets stuck in traffic. There's this start-stop mechanism throughout all the set pieces in this one that they just now it starts. It has stopped. It never reaches
second gear. The chases in this movie.
So I suppose with that said, we look at.
Let's bury Lloyd and go forth.
So meanwhile in Russia.
Okay, yeah.
I mean, I haven't kept up with Russia. I suppose they have done some cool editing, at least.
Battleship Potemkin?
Yeah, and some other stuff as well, I think. So I did watch Storm Over Asia by... excuse my pronunciation, Vsevolod Pudovkin. This was a suggestion I got from a guy at Twitter, Paul LCCRRR. I ain't talking words anymore. So, anyway, I haven't kept up with Russia. Mm-hmm. So I checked in on this one, and there's some stunning images throughout, but it's more of a historical drama. The editing, it ends with a fight scene. It's more of a historical drama up to this point. Okay. And there's these very tightly framed scuffles, and you see shining steels, and the lead character is basically tearing down a whole building, and then it goes into this stroboscopic editing, this guy is so angry that he almost destroys the image itself.
Oh.
And then he jumps out of a window and everything explodes.
Okay.
And then there's an army and riding on horses, and the editing suggests that the horses wind up a tornado through editing, and there are these images of trees blowing that almost look like those test footages of the atomic bomb. So before it happened, I might add. So there's some really interesting imagery in this one. At times, almost, a glimpse of much later action cinema where you maybe solve stuff in post. Because sometimes the fights look like they are just waving around a bit, and they cut immensely. So late American movie. But there is also some abstract artier editing going on here that reminds me a bit of maybe Hong Kong New Wave and stuff. Mm. So some really cool images.
Mm. We've also seen another Japanese movie, another samurai movie.
I've seen a few.
Yeah, you go to town every episode with the samurai movies, but this time I've tried to keep up with you. I've also seen Kurama Tengu.
Yeah, can I just ship in a brief on Chushingura, the truth?
Okay, go for it.
Yeah, so initially this is very text-heavy, and I had no subtitles, so I don't know. It started out like something I would turn off. But then they have this, in Japanese movies, they are so expressive when they are angry. Mm. And so powerful. There's this guy who pops a guy in the head and 10 guys just fall down.
Okay.
So it had my interest. And then throughout it do something that, sometimes, because I was almost going to say this was a first, but we shouldn't do that. But, sometimes things jump out at you.
You're not going to stop me from saying everything is a first?
No, of course. No, I won't do that to you.
Don't do that to me, man.
You are allowed. Yeah, yeah. But I would frame it more like sometimes you see things like it's the first time. Yeah. And it couldn't happen in a movie from this year, 2020. Yeah, yeah. Sometimes it's an image that you have seen thousand times, but someone just tweak it a bit and it just feels like it's pops out. Mm. And this long story is about whip pans.
Oh, yeah, it's a whip pan movie. Yeah, you talked about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I sent whip pans to you.
You send me some whip pans, and I mean, they're pretty...
The first couple are a bit shaky.
Yeah, it's a movie about someone trying to nail a whip pan.
Yeah, and he does.
Finally.
He or she does. the first couple are for... The cameraman is forced to adjust the whip move afterwards and go back. A whip pan is when you go fast from someone to someone else in this. It's in dialogue scenes. But just seeing them trying this out, I was thinking... And when it comes the third time, it sits perfectly. Mm. It's a perfect whip pan in here. From a face to another face. And it had me starting to believe, what if they would do this in the action scene? We all know that a samurai movie maybe doesn't have that much action throughout the duration, but they always seem to end on this one against an army. So it was really ramping up this anticipation, and it delivers.
Oh, it's a whip pan in action.
Yeah, we get an exemplary use of it. There's two guys fighting with swords, and the camera just is singing back and forth between them. It's very dynamic and exciting.
Cool.
So pay off. And a great use of environment in this one. It also starts snowing during the final battle, which is always a thing to behold. Snow during battles. So over to Kurama Tengu.
Yeah. What was the movie called that you talked about?
I talked about Chushingura.
Chushingura.
The Truth.
The Truth. And that was...
directed by Shôzô... Makino.
And that was like a generic samurai movie as well. All of these movies are samurai movies, essentially, from Japan.
Yeah, and I think a part of a serial. Mm.
Yeah, and...
as well, which is very obvious with Kurama Tengu.
Yeah, this isn't the first movie in the series about Kurama Tengu. Kurama Tengu, I'm guessing, is the lead character.
Yeah, he's another one of those hot-headed samurai, and he wants to overthrow the shogun.
Yeah.
The Shogunate.
Yes.
What is it? The Shogunate.
Yes, but when we open this movie, he is in prison, and we don't see him for like 40 minutes, because we instead, we have to make do with some 10-year-old boy that wants to free him, and some bad girl that goes around shooting people, and essentially, you're just confused.
Yeah, but there was a really the prolonged chase scene, which also has some whip pans, by the way. Really beautiful whip pan there, but when they hide
oh, a whip pan connoisseur, eh? Are you gonna write a thesis on whip pans in Japanese cinema or something?
Yeah, maybe someone should do that. We throw it out there. Anyway, the police is chase. This is funny. It's remotely something. When the police are chasing this kid and Kurama Tengu's best pal, they for some reason decide that it's too dangerous to run. We go undercover, and they. Hide behind and move around a portable wall, a couple of planks, and some hay.
Yeah.
And they just go about like this, their legs beneath, and some wood and some hay going around. So immediately when the police sees them, it's, oh, there they are. So and then they just disappear in midair.
So
I thought that was worth noting.
They were magicians.
And this girl that is interested in Kurama Tengu Otsuya, there's a very weird scene where the text informs us that with a cruel big brother, Otsuya led a miserable life, and she's just lying around, tied and gagged at home.
So
all day long.
So this is her. This is her ordinary going about.
It's a really cruel big brother. I don't want to know, actually, what's going on.
So anyway, Kurama Tengu finally gets himself out of jail. He attacks a bunch of people. And it's essentially when he gets out of the jail, he follows this escape route and teams up with the boy, or teams up. He essentially picks up the boy with his one arm and then fights off an entire army with his only arm and his feet, and we get some really nice fighting here.
When I watched this, and I gotta excuse it a bit, because it's very boring before it gets to the action. And what is it, 30 minutes in?
More, I think.
So I think I tortured you a bit. But there's some really cool stuff. For me, the most interesting, or one of the interesting things in this one, was when he is in prison and gets out, when he's tied and starts fighting the guards. So he gets one of the guards to chop off his ropes, and then when he gets a stick, They have some exchanges. And I thought the choreography was more complex here.
Mm.
Pretty long takes, more intricate movement, and some nice throws and stuff. And there's a, when he has gotten out, there's a really cool throw when they try to pick him up and he leaps out of their grip in some weird fashion. Mm. So pretty cool, intricate choreography, showing some firsts here, I think.
Yeah, I thought the fight was really good, actually. And he's doing some nice whirlwind thing with the sword. He picks up a sword. He's spinning around like a madman, keeping attackers at bay. And they're running away from their attackers. And then, all of a sudden, an intertitle informs us that it's the spring of 1863. And this mad woman with the gun is pounding on a door. we just got bamboozled. What happened to the fight?
Could it be a reel missing or something?
I certainly hope so. Because that was hilarious.
On par with Harold Lloyd's start-stop messing about.
Yeah, definitely. And I mean, this scene with the girl pounding on the door, her father refuses to let her in. And this goes on for a couple of minutes.
I mean, I think this is a new episode. I think the first episode ends with this big fight and something is missing here. Mm. And then when we get to the second episode, it feels like it just starts over with a slog. And it was a bit too much to handle because we have just survived through one of these slogs and gotten some beautiful action. Mm. And then it was just chopped off and back to soap opera land.
Yeah.
I mean, the long take when he is fighting lots of guys is beautifully constructed, except for those. There are these four guys jumping play horse or something. You know, in these Japanese movies, you always have these guys running around, watching out not to get hurt, which has worked great in the movies we have seen so far. But here it is really disruptive with four of these guys. I don't know what they are doing. Because it's such a great shot otherwise. Really annoying. I couldn't take my eyes off of them. They are jumping really silly.
So, yeah, essentially we get to the fight much quicker in this second episode. And
yeah,
and
Kramatenga's walked in a
and
trap.
And this fight is even better, I think.
Yeah, this is great stuff.
This is fantastic.
And he has been sent a fake letter to get to somewhere where he will be attacked. And it's so funny when one of his friends gets this fake letter. He's so upset over the fake letter that he grumpily storms out the door, viciously chewing the letter.
Yeah, so essentially Kurama Tengu has been set up and there's been a trap for him. He goes to a house, I guess it is, where a lot of bad guys are waiting to ambush him.
This is a death squad that the police have sent. And there's another death squad on their way. So we follow the other death squad and his pals getting together to go and help.
Yeah.
So it's also pretty cool parallel editing here between three separate thingies leading up to the fight. That works really well. I mean, another death squad moving in is it's a good thing when you already have a big ass death squad on the place.
Great. Silence of the Lambs, eat your heart out.
So Kurama Tengu just screams at them, "All right, it's dance time. Are you ready, cowards?"
And they're not really ready, but they give it their all. And essentially, Kurama Tengu, I mean, he slaughters like 30, 40 guys. And everybody's lying around on the floor dead as he's...
Yeah, they pile up.
Yeah, they pile up. I mean, it's almost like Kill Bill stuff, this fight.
The Banshee says something about that. The blood spurts out the bodies like flowing rivers or something. The only more poetic Banshee thingamajig in this one. And he is dual-wielding swords here as well. Did you notice that?
Yeah, great stuff. Great stuff.
And I think we both had one I won't say favorite shot, but a top five shots at least. there's a shot that only follows his leg movements.
Oh yeah, yeah, that's great. The camera only sees like his legs and the legs of his attackers, and it's almost like seeing someone play tennis or something. It's fantastic legwork.
Yes, great.
We don't need the sword fight. We only need the legs doing their thing. Great stuff. So yeah, they're really doing some intelligent action work here. High end stuff.
When he gets out, there's a short but pretty good 3-on-1 where the three attackers are attacking at the same time or taking turns. It's short, but it is great 3-on-1 work here.
And then we come to a duel at the end of this fantastic brawl. He faces off against the leader of the Death Squad. And they're going at each other fiercely, and they're cutting each other. So both are injured, and they're essentially collapsing in two piles. And they're like holding out their swords in front of them. So as, if you come any closer, I got my sword, don't try it. And they're like shouting at each other and being fatigued, and essentially they don't know what to do anymore. It's great.
It's great.
I love that when two guys get so exhausted and so beaten up that they can hardly stand anymore.
Yeah, and sorry to say it ends here. I think the Benji once again says, tune in next week.
Well, it's a great cliffhanger, but
It's a great cliffhanger, but we won't get to know how this played out.
I think it's time for us to return to Buster Keaton and talk about his second movie of 1928, The Cameraman. The first movie he made for MGM. So he is doing this movie called The Cameraman, where he plays an...
What is he?
Well...
A tin portrait.
He's a photographer in the beginning.
But
there's portraits.
At that time as well, outdated technique that he is working with.
Yeah, it's almost like if you see someone today using a Polaroid camera. I guess that is the equivalent of what Buster is using here when he goes around on the streets and trying to get people to pay money to get their portrait taken.
I gotta say, initially, this movie really had me sitting up, because the first shot of the movie is one of cinema's greatest explosions ever. But it's so short. It's a couple of seconds. There's a war scene, because there's a montage in the beginning that... talks about cinematographers, war journalists, or that shoot dangerous stuff. So we see soldiers, and a house explodes. The debris filling the sky, once again with these angles and stuff that you were talking about. Mm. It's just too cool
dreamy.
For school. It's dreamy.
I think it might be a real shot, because as you said, he used a lot of real documentary shots.
Yeah, that
movie.
Was what I thought too, but it's so goddamn good quality of the image as well. But probably, because the explosion looks really dangerous, because people are so close to it as well, when the debris starts flying, and it cuts away at that moment, so maybe you don't want to see the rest. Real war thingy, but so opens on a start a strong note. It drops a bit for me.
Well, it gets a bit samey, because essentially Buster is trying, he is infatuated with a girl almost from the start here. And the girl works for MGM, as it happens, but not for the movie part. It's for the journalist part. So they're making these journal movies, essentially filming these current event things. Well, they're essentially being like journalists of today, where they're all being forced to do moving pictures material. Nobody reads anymore. Everybody wants to see something happen. And that was essentially the same, I guess, in the 20s, at least for these journal filmmakers. So he tries to get a job at this company. But he has a hard time since he's using this obsolete camera, and everybody thinks he's a big boob, as the saying were in these times. So he has, he's down on his luck as usual.
Yeah, but I don't. For me, the romance just doesn't work here, and it gets lots of airtime. He basically just, when they meet, or they are in a crowded place, he stands and sniffs her hair, and he's a bit awkward, and she mostly seems to feel sorry for him or think that he's a minor nuisance most of the time. Mm. So it gets. It becomes a bit of a slog for me, but it picks up, and there's a couple of great set pieces here as well.
Yeah, I do think we both agree that the movie picks up when he gets on a date with the girl, and they decide to go to the swimming hall.
Yeah, but it's weird because I think she says. No, he says, "Do you want to take a long walk on Sunday?" But she's busy. So, but then she got a change of plans. So they're gonna hook up. But they go to the bathhouse.
Yeah, there's a great scene where he awaits the call.
Yes.
She says that. Well, I might call you. Can I get your number? Yeah, of course. So she gets the number of his apartment hotel, I guess, where he lives, and whereas there's only one phone for the entire house. So there's 10 floors or something.
But yet again, he just sits at home waiting for this call. He's a bit weird.
He has nothing else going on, this guy.
No.
So whenever he hears the telephone ringing, he runs down the stairs, only to find out, oh, it was for someone else. Oh, you picked up the phone. Okay. And there's a great shot. They use this elevator camera. I think this is one of the first movies, maybe together with the Harold Lloyd movie that used it.
It's wonderful. But we saw it as well in, didn't we see something similar at least in, wasn't it in The Three Musketeers?
Oh yeah,
when
we did.
When we went up the tower.
I think this might be one of the first comedies at least to use the elevator shot.
And I mean, it's a beautifully perceived scene.
Yeah, I mean, he walks, essentially it's like a Wes Anderson dollhouse cutout of the, so you get the stairs.
And Wes Anderson ain't got nothing on
in
on
Buster. 2D form. You see him from in a profile manner going up the stairs, in a zigzag manner up the stairs. And essentially he is so preoccupied with this phone, and he's thinking about the girl, and he's so in deep thoughts that he goes all the way up the house and falls over at the top when there's no stair left.
Yeah, he's up at the roof. And then later he is so excited when there is a call that he runs too far and ends up in the basement as well. So and the camera moves. It's great. It's a great shot. Finally, they manage to get on a date.
Yeah.
And we do get a very taut economical banana peel variation. I really like
you love these banana peel variations, man.
He gets into this really tight little dressing room to change to his bath clothes, and another guy rushes in and is gonna change, and Buster tries out, this is my dressing room, shut up or it will be your coffin. And they proceed to undress Tumble for a long duration, very yeah. long. It just goes on, and it's like it's almost like a precursor to an enclosed environment fight, but even tighter. I was thinking about elevator fights. We love a fight in an elevator. It almost has a hint of this going on. It's so tight, and they climb each other, and
yeah, they really get tussled around. And I mean, Buster gets this fantastic look in his face.
Yes.
I mean, I haven't seen him agitated in this way for in any movie. I mean, he really looks peeved here in a way I haven't seen
some of those
before.
Hits probably,
and he gets
connects. This is so tight.
I mean, he also gets this very nice hairdo, very like scruffy hair. Very unlike the 20s, of course, where you're supposed to have Crispin Glover hair all the time. But
maybe that's why he's so upset.
Yeah, my hair.
Don't touch
the do, man.
Wasn't supposed to be happen.
Yeah. It's a great scene. I agree.
It's the centerpiece. I mean, there's throughout the movie. There's this wonderful staging of lack of space in these urban environments. I mean, everything is packed and crowded. When he's trying to get a seat on the bus together with her, when they're going to this location that we are at, he can't. He's pushed up on the roof of the bus. Yeah. Or the second floor, so seemingly impossible to get a place by your date on the bus, on the bathhouse. There's dudes flocking around her. He can't almost get to her. So there's no way to assert yourself, which is really conveyed in this changing room scene. In earlier Buster Keaton movies, I have complained sometimes that he is infatuated with open nature, that he often is out, I don't know, doing stuff with horses or falling in a river and stuff like that. He seems like he likes to be out in the nature, and I felt more strongly for Harold Lloyd's urban explorations, climbing skyscrapers and being run over by cars. And now when Buster is in the city here, there is no place for him. I think there is something here.
It's a beautiful analogy there. Yeah, and as you said, I mean, the chaos continues out in the swimming pool. He jumps into the water, and well, the tussle in the changing room has made them use each other's swimming suits. So
yeah, there's a mix
this
up.
Big guy has Buster Keaton's very small swimming suit, and Buster Keaton is simply bathing in the other guy's swimming suit. And so when he dives into the water later, he dives out of the swimming suit and is essentially naked in the water. And there is some he tries to steal a lady's pants as well. So yeah, brouhaha in the water.
Brouhaha in the water. Anyway.
Anyway. So.
But anyway.
He's down on his luck again because the girl.
Can't
the girl,
catch a break.
Yeah, he can't catch a break with the girl. His rival for her shows up and gives them a ride home when it starts raining. But since it's a two-seat car, it's only the girl and the rival that can get the. The baldachin, or what you call it, the
roof,
essentially, of the car. So Buster has to sit behind in a small seat in the rain.
It's a pretty good rain.
Yeah, very good rain. That's great rain. better rain than in Steamboat Bill Jr. I mean, it looks really like they're throwing buckets of water at him.
So he gets an insider tip, finally. She has overheard some Chinese, I think, who are going to do something during a lion dance festival in Chinatown.
Yeah, it essentially becomes a war in Chinatown.
Yeah, so the Tong War breaks out. So this is the big set piece. Yeah, well, apart from the small big set piece in the changing room.
Yeah, and the big set piece is equally as good, I would say. It's crazy stuff happening. Everybody is shooting at everybody, and Buster is in the middle of it all, trying to capture everything with his camera. And
there's some great
stuff.
And
he's totally fearless, man. He just cranks that camera at everything. And he orchestrates scenes. When someone is missing a dagger, he finds a dagger for them. Oh, here you go. Okay, continue wrestling. I'll just crank the camera.
There's a couple of guys fighting on the ground, and he gives one of them a knife to get better footage.
Yeah.
And they have machine guns. And earlier, Buster has picked up a monkey. We forgot to mention. But due to circumstances, he now has a monkey that dresses a bit like him. So, and there's a scene. I mean, these guys have these heavy machine guns. And there's a wonderful scene where Monkey and Buster side by side, Buster cranking the camera and the monkey is cranking the machine gun. So both are shooting.
nice visual. Nice image.
Yeah, it's a great image.
Yeah, and we also get one of his famous stunts when he stands on a palisade or something.
On the scaffolding.
Yeah, the scaffolding. He's cranking a camera on top of a scaffolding, and the scaffolding folds over, and he is he's jettisoned down, and he keeps cranking all the way down.
Yeah, I gotta keep cranking.
Yeah, gotta keep cranking.
I was hoping we would see a shot of that in the final reel. Spoiler alert. When we get to see his footage.
Yeah, from point of view. Yeah, that would have been great.
Yeah, point of view shot would have been so cool. Mm.
This fight goes on very long, and finally ends up in a room with some seedy characters, and the police bust in, saves the day, and he almost gets driven off to the insane asylum because one cop thinks he has this thing going with
the cop throughout the movie, and earlier this is a bug-eyed cop, squinty bug-eyed Popeye cop who has made a medical exam on Buster to see if he is goofy, testing his reflexes. It's an odd medical exam, I suppose, but now he has decided that Buster is a loon. He shows up at the wrong place at the wrong time every goddamn time.
Yeah, I wonder a bit about these expressions that the cop is making. It seems like it's become a staple in comedy for ages after that. Like this character reacting to someone being crazy in some way, or something untowardly happening to him, and he has this expression that goes you, or something like that.
In text or in face?
In face. Oh, yeah, he shows up at the MGM News Journal office with this footage that he thinks he has. But when he opens the camera, he has the movie reel isn't there. It's an old movie reel with only half a frame or something. So he's being laughed at and thrown out of the MGM offices.
Yeah, it's over.
And he feels like, man, I don't know what to do anymore. And he's down on his luck again. And he goes out to film a motorboat race. And he's cranking some stuff on top of a boat.
Yeah, cranking some stuff,
cranking
baby.
Some stuff out on a boat. And the girl and his rival is going in a motorboat as well. The motorboat goes crazy. And both the girl and rival gets into the water. And the motorboat, I mean, that's great stuff. When the motorboat is circling them in this swirling manner, going round and round the girl. Like she's trapped in a maelstrom of motorboat. That's great stuff. And Buster, of course, saves the day. He saves her. She's unconscious. He goes away to get some medicine. The rival...
He gets all the medicine.
The rival, who ditched the girl to save himself, finds the girl on the beach and like, well, looks like I saved you, huh? And she's like, oh, my savior, and goes away with him. And then Buster gets back with medicine, finds out she isn't there anymore. And man, now I'm really down on my luck.
Yeah, he breaks down. And the camera pulls back and reveals the monkey cranking an unhappy ending. More or less.
Yeah, but...
So the monkey shoots the movie. Yeah. No.
Yeah, so, yeah, exactly.
It's a great shot.
It's a great shot. Well. And it is also the monkey that saves the day for Buster. Because the monkey exchanged the footage of the Chinatown massacre. We saw
It switched reels.
We saw in an earlier shot that he had done that, and Buster, like, gave him a scolding. You're not supposed to do that. But he does that after the Chinatown massacre. So Buster actually got that footage. He just doesn't know it. And since the monkey has cranked the ending of that reel when Buster saves the girl. So he leaves the reel with MGM people and says, you can have that for free. I don't want anything to do with a camera anymore. I'm out of here. And then they're like, oh, let's look at his footage for a laugh or something. And then all of a sudden, it's great! The Chinatown massacre, oh my god, such presence! Oh my god, those shots, those frames! I've never seen anything as good as this! And then, what is this, a motorboat accident? And the girl is like, what? You didn't save me? Buster Keaton saved me? What? And so she runs away, brings Buster back, and yeah, we get a happy ending.
And that's the end of the puppet show.
Yeah, and that's the end of this show. I mean, I'm totally fadu, as you say in Swedish.
I think you kept up pretty well.
Well, I tried to crank in an timely manner, but I feel I undercranked a bit. I overcranked a bit.
You got crunked.
I got crunked, man.